The story I'm going to tell tonight is another story about a flood. But this is a political flood. And this is what happens to when a country becomes highly dependent on one resource, this resource being bitumen, without a national conversation or debate about the pace and scale of its development. And that's what I'll be focusing on tonight. Let me first thank the people who brought me here, Council of Canadians, radio station, thank you Michael Welch, thank you Shirley, and the University of Manitoba for making it possible for me to be here. And thank you for coming out. Alright, so just as the waters have flooded Lake St. Martin, Canada's political waters have now been flooded by this resource. So, I'm going to talk about Harper, I'm going to be talking about pipelines, and I'm going to be really talking about the corruption of political conversation and debate in this country. So, here we have a prime minister, he comes from Alberta, comes in, and Alberta has been ruled by one party for 42 years, and it's very much a province dependent on the rapid development of its hydrocarbons. And so he comes from this province, he's now the prime minister of Canada, and he has a vision, and his vision is that bitumen will become this extremely, become pave the new road to prosperity for Canada, and then in the process, Canada will become an energy superpower. And he doesn't announce this vision in Canada, no, he announces this vision in London, England in 2006, at a speech that virtually no Canadian heard. And then he encounters a problem, and the problem is this. A company by the name of TransCanada proposes to build a pipeline from Alberta all the way to the Texas coast. This is the Keystone XL pipeline. And Prime Minister Stephen Harper calls this a no-brainer, but then all of a sudden there's a huge and ferocious debate in the United States about this pipeline. And a debate about its contents, a debate about its carbon footprint, a debate about who's going to benefit from this pipeline, a debate about the risks it imposes on landowners in the U.S. Midwest who live on top of the Ogallala Aquifer, the largest freshwater in North America. Well, this is not something that the Canadian government expected. So, they come up with a plan B. And what is plan B? Plan B is, alright, maybe the Americans don't want this soil. Oh, and by the way, there are two other developments taking place in the United States, aside from concerns about climate change and groundwater. American consumption of oil has been in decline for 5 years. At the same time, that domestic production of oil in the United States has been on the increase over the last 3 years, largely due to the shale oil play in North Dakota. So, Canada then has a double problem. Right? The Americans don't even want this bloody pipeline. Some of them are concerned about climate change. The American demand for oil is going down, and American oil production is going up. So what do we do? Well, okay, the solution then is we take our bitumen and we're going to send it off to China. We might have a few problems there because there is a province in the way. It's called British Columbia. But hey, why don't we put out a whole variety of different ideas. So we could expand the Kinder Morgan pipeline, we can add, maybe ship bitumen by rail, maybe we can build the Northern Gateway pipeline and to the port of Kitimat and do it that way. So all of these proposals suddenly come on board. And the idea is, well, you know, here's the Great Bear Rainforest, here's the last of the world's temperate rainforest, an extraordinary geography, and territory largely controlled by First Nations. And the federal government said, well, to hell with all this, we're still going to put this pipeline through and we're going to have super tankers going up and down the shoreline. And why are we going to do this? Well, we're going to do this because we feel we need to put more cars on the road in Shanghai, right? That's what it's all about. And meanwhile, people in British Columbia are saying, over our dead bodies. I kid you not. Coastal First Nations have said, this pipeline will not pass. And they mean it. Environmentalists have said, this pipeline will not pass. And they mean it. The communities of Prince Rupert, of Terrace, of Smithers, all along the pipeline route have said, this is not what we want in our country. So then, what is this huge national story then about pipelines? What is it all connected to, and what do Canadians really need to start thinking about? Fundamentally, it's a story about extreme and difficult oil. It's a story about the fact that business as usual, as we know it, as we've taken it for granted for many, many years, is gone. Cheap oil is a thing of the past, and now we are developing stuff that is not cheap. It is not politically cheap, economically cheap, environmentally cheap. This is all stuff that requires more sacrifices and greater costs. So, high capital, high energy intensity, high complexity, high risk, or as Merle might put it, lots and lots of flooding. All right, so what do these projects look like? Well, first and foremost, we know a lot about the tar sands, and it is the classic example of this new, difficult hydrocarbons, where you literally have to dig up 2 tons of sand to produce 1 barrel of oil. When you do that, as Jeff Rubin would put it, you know you're at the bottom of the ninth inning. Offshore oil in the Gulf of Mexico. When you have to drill 2 miles below the floor of the ocean to recover oil, you also know that you are at the bottom of the ninth inning. This is among the world's most expensive oil, just as bitumen production is. And then we have this new phenomenon, all right, with shale oil and shale gas, where we are drilling a mile or two below the ground, and then drilling another mile horizontally, and then setting off explosive charges to crack open these rock formations as dense as concrete. And then to keep them open, we will shoot down at very high pressure tons of millions of gallons of water combined with tons of sand and tons of chemicals. When you have to do and resort to these kinds of brute force, and these are extreme activities, you know that the era of cheap oil is over. All right, so a few words about it, because you guys are a good 2 provinces away, and you probably don't even know how, in many ways, you have been affected by this resource. Although there are lots of Manitobans from rural Manitoba who are working in Fort McMurray. So here's the resource. It is, industry prefers to call it oil sands, and yet I do not see oil floating on top of sand here. What you see is that this is a third-grade hydrocarbon. It has badly been degraded by biological activity over 300 million years, and some of this stuff is all caught and meshed in water, sand, and clay. And so about 18% of what that guy is holding in his hands is bitumen, and the rest is sand, clay, and water. This is one hell of a dirty resource. And to pull it out of the ground is one thing, but then you have to refine it. It is such a poor quality, it has so much carbon and so little hydrogen, you've got to pull the carbon out, and you've got to add hydrogen in. That hydrogen is coming from natural gas. You're cracking natural gas for the hydrogen to enrich the bitumen so that you can produce something called synthetic crude. This is a part of that process. And in the process of doing that, you're producing every year 5 million to 6 million tons of petroleum coke that are ending up on the landscape, not to mention millions and millions of tons of sulfur. And you can actually see, they're like pyramids on the landscape up in Fort McMurray. In fact, the bitumen industry in Fort McMurray produces more petroleum coke than the entire coal industry in Canada. That's how large this thing. Now, at one point, the Alberta government referred to it as the magic sand pile. They said, you know, this is going to be our nature has created the most fabulous sand pile. And here in the tar sands of Alberta, imagine it, even the Alberta government using that expression, tar sands, is a unique opportunity for industry, an opportunity and a challenge in the free land of free enterprise. Well, the big really problem for years and years was, how do we get this resource out of the ground in an economic way? And so they struggled for decades. Should we mine it? Should we steam it? What's the best way to get it out of the ground? In the 1960s, a geologist came up with the idea and said, well, why don't we just nuke it? And so he took his idea to the Alberta government, and they said, oh, that's a great idea. And then he took it, the idea to the American government, and the American government said, well, we've got a bomb for you. And then they went to Emeco Richfield, and Emeco Richfield said, look, we've got a spot for you, just, you know, 70 kilometers south of Fort McMurray. You know, we'll drill a big hole in the ground, and then we'll drop the A-bomb in there, and then we'll melt all this bitumen, and then we'll pump it up to the surface like conventional oil. And they thought, you know, this will be a great thing, right? And I kid you not, this was called Operation Cauldron. So Canadians were very serious about doing this, and it was Americans who finally said, had a senior second thought about it, said, well, maybe this is not the way to go. The Russians, however, took the idea and went with it, and they set off a couple of nuclear bombs in their heavy oil deposits in Siberia, only to discover that there's yet no market for radioactive oil. So, but we nearly went there. Eventually, we figured out, okay, what's the cheapest and most economic way to get this stuff out of the ground? Well, here it is. And this is what the oil and gas industry, in all of its wonderful hubris, refers to as innovation, a truck and shovel operation. That's it. That's how we're getting it out of the ground. Big trucks, though. I mean, 400-ton trucks and big shovels. Massive. And they're not made in Canada, by that. They're mostly made in the United States. But that's so this is what Canadians have been doing for years. We're miners. We are natural resource developers. We know how to dig really big holes in the ground, get stuff out fast, sell it to other people for cheap, and add no value to it. And that's exactly what we're doing in the tar sands. Now, here's another critical thing that economists and politicians often neglect when they're talking about this new era of difficult oil, is how damn expensive it is. And if you look at the chart, you can see at the bottom it takes about $10 to produce oil from the Middle East still. And if you look up at the other end of the chart, you see that bitumen and offshore oil is in the range of, you know, 80 to 100 bucks. So this is the world's most expensive hydrocarbon. And then what they don't want to tell you is that, look, North America has developed in the last 100 years on oil that costs less than 10 bucks a barrel. How are we going to run an economy when oil is now anywhere between 80 and 100 bucks? And when all of our infrastructure, everything that we have built, was built on the assumption that cheap oil would be with us forever. Here's another really good cost comparison. So it takes about $8 billion to develop an oil field in the Middle East that will produce 1 million barrels of oil a day. In contrast, heavy oil in Canada and Venezuela requires capital expenditures of $35 to $45 billion to produce 1 million barrels. This is another indication that business as usual, as we know it, is over when your oil requires that intensity of capital investment to produce it. And of course, there's a subject nobody in Canada wants to talk about the carbon footprint of all this. You know, we once thought we were moral, ethical people that actually cared about climate change and basic science and what happens to other people around the planet. And this is among the world's most carbon-intensive hydrocarbons. There are a few others that have a footprint a little bit larger than this in the Middle East because of high CO2 content or hydrogen sulfide. Content because of excessive flaring, but we're in the top here. Here's another indication of how poor this resource is, and this is the American Petroleum Institute, how they create petroleum products by their density and type, and bitumen, again, is right at the end of the chart because it is so damn thick and so dense that it will not move through a pipeline unless you dilute it with natural gas condensate or light oil. Now, how much natural gas do we use every day to produce bitumen in northern Alberta? That's another issue we, as Canadians, we don't really like to discuss too much. But But every day we use and burn enough natural gas to produce bitumen to heat 6 million homes in Canada. That is an extraordinary, and that figure is going up. So we're using one resource, natural gas, to produce a much even dirtier resource called bitumen. And as a consequence, the energy returns we're getting from bitumen production are very, very low. Some economists would call this a great example of energy cannibalism. We're using one energy source of much higher value to produce an energy source of a much more value. Or as some people in the patch say, it's a good example of taking gold and turning it into lead. Here's a guy that used to work for Statoil. A guy who works in the oil patch, Robert Skinner, very interesting character, and he's appalled by our waste of resources here. And so here's the story. Grandpa, did you do that? Did you take gas down from the Arctic, or gas from northern British Columbia, down to Alberta to boil water, to make steam, to melt tar out of the oil sands, then use more natural gas to produce hydrogen, to make the tar molecules into gasoline, so North Americans could drive 5-ton vehicles 5 kilometers to spend 15 minutes riding stationary bikes? Grandpa, did we really do that? And the answer is yes, we're doing that. This was not how the original scientists who worked on the tar sands thought how the resource should be used. This is Carl Clark, Scottish scientist, brilliant fellow, worked 4 years of his life in the tar sands before he died of cancer, I might add. And he saw bitumen production as a second line of defense against dwindling oil supplies. He did not regard it as a replacement. And he did not regard it as a replacement because he recognized the huge capital, energy, and environmental costs associated with its production. One of the reasons that we are going about now cannibalizing other resources as well as going after these extreme hydrocarbons has a lot to do with the fact that with population growth and oil and the role that oil has played in it. So if you just take a quick look at this graph, you'll see that really until 15th century, 16th century, until we started burning hydrocarbons in the form of coal, our numbers stayed below 1 billion. Hydrocarbons allow us to transcend all limits, all boundaries that the natural world had set up until that time. And so oil and hydrocarbons have served as the Viagra of the species. And here we've got, here we go from 1 billion over the space of 150 years to more than 7 billion people. And all of this has happened at the same time that the cheap stuff is disappearing. So peak oil, as defined by Colin Campbell and other people, is very much like going to the bar and, before you know it, you're staring depletion in the face. But in this case, this is a bar that will be closing permanently down the line. And it's not so much a case of the pub running out of beer, it's a case of the people going to the pub and no longer being able to afford what is left. So what have we done to the tar sands, and why has this project so dramatically changed the political and economic character of the country? Let's just look at its growth in scale, of which we've had no debate. So here's 1984, 1997, and you can see the first mining projects here, Syncrude and Suncor. Here, 2002, we're adding more mining projects north of there, Shell, CNRL is beginning construction, 2005. 2008, we're up to 1.2 million barrels a day now, and here's 2009, 2011, and we have now excavated enough material to build 7 Panama canals, and we are on our way to digging a collective hole in northern Alberta that will be the size of Delaware or the state of Rhode Island. That's approximately 4,000 square kilometers, and that is just for the mining portion of this project. The proposal British Columbia, the Northern Gateway project, would expand this project threefold. Would take current production levels of 2 million barrels a day and ramp it up to approximately 6 million barrels a day by 2035. And it would do so, again, without any national debate or conversation, because the mandate of the National Energy Board is not to look at this fact, at the impact of expansion in the tar sands. The mandate of the National Energy Board is only to look at the environmental impact of the pipeline across the Rocky Mountains into British Columbia. They have no mandate to look at the other end and the impact of filling that pipeline and expanding tar sands growth threefold. Here's David Hughes, a remarkable character, worked for Natural Resources Canada for more than 30 years, primarily one of the premier energy experts in the country, a man who's mapped most of Canada's coal deposits. The oil supply, something here he's talking about Northern Gateway. The oil supply will grow by 217% over 210 levels by 2035, seemingly in order to justify the added capacity of the Northern Gateway pipeline. This is highly optimistic and represents a focus on corporate growth at the expense of the long-term energy security and environmental interests of Canadians. It is not in our interest as a people to expand a project this big, this dirty, this controversial, this fast. Now, there are a number of impacts on Canada. One of them is the Dutch disease. As Canadians, we seem very adverse to even having a conversation about this. Stephen Harper and the boys in Ottawa say it doesn't exist, it's a myth. There's no such thing as the Dutch disease. Tom Leclerc is saying, you know what, I think it is. I think it's very much alive and well in Canada. And so you've got Harper and the guy saying, well, you know, this is a bitumen production, this is Canada's new economic engine, look how big it is, what a nice, wonderful Hummer the tar sands is for the nation. They don't talk about the downside of putting all your eggs in one basket. And so the first thing we have is we now have a petro currency, is that our dollar goes up and down with the price of oil. And it moves up and down like a yo-yo, extremely volatile. And that's because 30% of our export revenue now comes from the export of oil. All right, so we are rapidly becoming an oil exporting nation or a petro state that is becoming more and more dependent on one resource. Our currency now reflects this fact. So how does that affect other businesses in the country? Well, if you're a manufacturer and you were used to doing business in the United States when the Canadian dollar was, you know, 80 cents to the American dollar, and now we've got a petro currency that goes up with the price of oil, you're put out of business. And what we've seen in the last couple of years has been an extraordinary reduction in the manufacturing sectors of Ontario. So here's the Dutch disease, and it's named after a similar phenomenon happened in Holland in the 1970s. The Economist magazine, a great business magazine, no less, said that there was a natural gas boom, the Dutch went crazy, and so they went from an economy that looked like this, that was did a lot of manufacturing, and there was a lot of agricultural stuff going on, and food processing, to one that became more and more heavy on gas production. The guilder went wild and crazy, the manufacturing base shrunk, and that's what you end up with at the end of the day. And so we can see sort of this phenomenon in Canada in a number of ways. You can see the blue line here is crude oil and oils obtained from bitumen minerals, and you can see the car and auto manufacturing industry, the red graph, going a different direction. So here's a financial group in Montreal describing this whole scenario. A severe case of the Dutch disease has dramatically reduced the breadth of the cannabis business sector over the past decade, hollowing out manufactured goods, exporters, and making the nation increasingly reliant on commodity demand. Canada has often been referred to in jest as the 51st state due to its historical reliance on the U.S. as a key export market. However, it is becoming more accurate to regard Canada as another province of China. That is who we now produce resources for. Here's a graph that really illustrates the dramatic reduction in share of employment in the manufacturing sector since the turn of the century. So we've got 15% in 1998, and now we're down to almost less than 10% of the population involved in manufacturing. Now, not all of that contraction is due to rapid bitumen production and to our petro currency, but economists suggest that at least half of it is. So 50% of the job losses in that industry are all due to the Dutch disease phenomenon. Another aspect to bitumen production that also is dramatically affecting the country, Peter Longhi said, look, this is a raw product, we should be adding value to it, and this is where the jobs are in turning bitumen into jet fuel and gasoline and hydrocarbons, other hydrocarbons, plastics, and so on. He said, Alberta should be adding value to this resource. That is how you diversify and grow your economy over time. That's how you keep your jobs at home. That is not the model we are pursuing. We are putting this stuff in pipelines and we are exporting it abroad to the United States. We're adding no value. But it's something we know how to do, right? We've done this for 400 years. We took furs out of Hudson Bay and we sent them to England and Europe to be made into fashion apparel for Europeans. Robin Allen, who's a great economist in British Columbia, says, look, Northern Gateway represents an inflationary price shock, which will have a negative and prolonged impact on the Canadian economy by reducing output, employment, labor income, and government revenues, because it's all about shipping raw bitumen to Asia to be refined and upgraded in China. Now, here's another thing that we now have to deal with as a resource developing nation. We are rapidly becoming a petro state. And petro states are very interesting and they're very dysfunctional and they're totally different than other nations. Because, first of all, they're sitting on a pile of hydrocarbons and by that geographical good luck, they begin to think that by sitting on hydrocarbons, we become smarter and smarter over time. And also more and more arrogant. And this is very much the sort of Alberta's terrible experience with oil over the last 42 years. But here's what petro states do. They take the money and they run and they become stupid. So petro states rely on an unsustainable development trajectory fueled by an exhaustible resource, a finite resource, and the very returns produced by this resource form an implacable barrier to change. In other words, you get so addicted to the money, you can't think of any other way of living or doing things. Now, Terry Carr is a really brilliant American political scientist who's written the most about petro-states, and her book is called The Paradox of Plenty. It was written in 1998, and I think it is probably one of the most brilliant pieces of political writing I have read in a long, long time. And it wasn't until I started reading Terry Carr that I really began to understand the province I live in. And that I really want, and that's Alberta. So what is a petro state and how do they work? Well, the first thing they do, they get addicted to cash from exploiting hydrocarbons. And then they use that cash to run their government. And then they use that cash to lower taxes to make everyone feel warm and fuzzy about hydrocarbon production. So they get everyone to buy in to this windfall. And then the next thing they do is, because the money comes in so easily, that they start overspending like hell. I mean, the Alberta government it has been running a deficit now for 4 years in a row. We're in the process of borrowing money abroad to build infrastructure we probably don't need because we want to expand bitumen production in ways that are no longer sustainable or no longer desirable. The other thing about having all this money from hydrocarbons and from one very lucrative resource is that we begin to see concentration of power over time. So you go, one of the things about petro states, go to Texas. And Texas was ruled by the Democratic Party for 90 friggin' years. It's now been ruled by the Republican Party for 30 years. Huey Long and his gang ruled Louisiana for, and his family actually, other relatives, ruled Louisiana for about 20 to 30 years. You had Gaddafi in Libya, 42 years. The Conservatives in Alberta, 42 years. The PRI in Mexico, on the basis of Mexico's oil wealth, ruled that country for 70 friggin' years. Margaret Thatcher had about the longest reign of any prime minister since World War II on the basis of oil wealth from the North Sea and on it goes. So if you're sitting on a pile of hydrocarbons and the government is there, they can use that oil wealth to extend their political shelf life. And there's very little to stop them. The other thing about the United States is they don't want you to ask any questions about the money. How much money is being collected? Where is it going? Is anything being saved for the future? Does Canada have a sovereign fund? Who's making all the money? What are the royalty rates? What are the corporate taxes rates? Who's reporting on them? Where's the transparency? And Harper does not want you to ask any of those questions. And that is why he and his political cronies created a little organization called Ethical Oil, saying, don't worry, everything that Canadians do is ethical. Because they don't want you to ask questions about the money. And by the way, oil is all about the money. The other thing that happens that is disastrous in Petro states, whether we're talking about countries in the Middle East or North Africa or Africa or Louisiana or Wyoming and Texas and Alaska or Alberta for that matter, is that when you stop taxing your citizens, all right, Texas has no sales tax, basically no income tax, same thing with Louisiana, same thing in Wyoming, go to Saudi Arabia, no sales tax, virtually no taxes of any kind. Go to Alaska, the same thing in Alberta, that was our advantage. We have the lowest taxes in the country. All right, what the hell is going on there? What bargain is being made there? If you're not being taxed, you're not being represented. So who is being represented? Well, the people who are developing the resource that make all the money are going to be represented. And that's the bargain that's been struck in Alberta, and that's the bargain that Harper wants to strike with each and every Canadian. Guys, I'm going to lower your taxes. We're going to run on hydrocarbon revenues. But don't expect me to represent you. That's not part of the deal. No taxation, no representation. And so we have a phenomenon, you know, King Ralph, as he was known in Alberta, the great wonderful alcoholic that he was, ran the province for 14 years. Chavez, great example of a left-wing Petro politician. Venezuelans aren't any richer as a result of his 12 years of spending. Sarah Palin, good example of a right-wing Petro politician. Great example of a North African dictator. Vladimir Putin, another Petro politician. He's nationalized Russia's oil and gas assets to strengthen and maintain his hold on power. Margaret Thatcher, she used all of the proceeds from the development of the North Sea to fund her right-wing political revolution in England, and she did not save a nickel or a dime. Bushes, on it goes, and here's our Petro guy, right? Worked on the railroads as a kid. His father was an accountant for Imperial Oil. This guy is more big oil than Mitt Romney in the United States. And we can begin to see his agenda. And let's talk about how petropolitics is now really beginning to dramatically change the character of the country. All right, we really saw this, let's say, first of all, with climate change. All right? Don't give a damn about climate change. Neither of us saw the rating going. Because if Canada were to give a damn about climate change, that would mean that the Ottawa would receive less revenue from hydrocarbon production. The Alberta government would receive less revenue from hydrocarbon production. And these are two governments that cannot see a future for themselves without hydrocarbon production. So climate change is basically not being addressed in this country in any shape or form. So here's the Auditor General, less in Ottawa, saying Environment Canada's forecasts show that all of our targets will not be met with existing measures. That Environment Canada does not know how much the regulatory approach will cost the Canadian economy for effective climate change action. And the regulatory approach Canada, chosen by Harper and company. company is not supported by an implementation plan designed to meet Canada's 2020 target. So we have a target for 2020. There's no way in hell we're going to make it, especially if we build two pipelines, Keystone and Gateway. Every climate change scientist I have talked to has said, you cannot build those pipelines and meet any reasonable climate change goals in this country, period. Then along comes, all right, so we know that Harper is more than just a climate change skeptic. He doesn't give a damn. All right, don't forget that Canada is in the top 10 CO2 emitters on the planet. There's not a lot of us, but we use a hell of a lot of energy, and we have been doing that for more than 100 years, and as a consequence, we have a moral responsibility to take some kind of leadership on this issue, and we have it. We've abdicated our responsibility, and in the process, we are toasted our international reputation. Then along comes this thing, in the springtime, we have a budget bill. All right, so what do we throw in the budget bill? Oh, we don't do a budget. We have 480 pages basically outlining a whole new Canada that guts almost every single piece of environmental legislation in this country that would stand in the way of Chinese-funded pipelines or Chinese investments in the tar sands. So the Canadian Environmental Assessment Act is ditched. Canadian Environmental Protection Act is undercut. The National Roundtable on the Economy and Environment killed. Why? Because it produced reports saying that climate change is an issue that Canadians should pay attention to. Canadian Environmental Assessment Agency, seriously weakened. Kyoto Protocol, gone. Fisheries Act, gutted. Energy Board Act, nuclear Safety Control Act, undermined. Water and Environmental Monitoring, cut. Science agencies across the country where anyone involved in producing environmental data, gone. Experimental Lakes Project, one of the finest pieces of scientific research in this country, taking place in Northern Ontario for more than 40 years, gone. These are extreme measures. This is our vision. This is it. We muzzle scientists at scientific conferences, this one in Montreal, where you can see the government minder right next to the scientist there to watch over his shoulder to make say he says he doesn't say anything that embarrasses the government. This kind of censorship has been condemned by some of the world's top science magazines, such as Nature. I said, what the hell's going on in Canada? Why are you censoring your scientists? Why is it that we have a group of federal scientists today in California releasing the contents of federal research on the tar sands when they have not yet released that research here in Canada? Why? Because it's damning stuff. It's confirming everything that we suspected about this project, that it has a huge footprint, and that contaminants are traveling much further than we thought, and they're having a dramatic impact not only on the land, but on the water and on fish and on wildlife. Here's Nature. Prominent researchers have been prevented from discussing published peer-reviewed literature. Policy directives and emails reveal a confused and Byzantine approach to the press, prioritizing message control and showing little understanding of the importance of the free flow of scientific knowledge. It is time for the Canadian government to set its scientists free. We have not seen any evidence of this happening yet. I mean, these are, again, extraordinary developments. I never, as a Canadian, thought that I would see the day where my federal government was actively censoring federal science and was actively moving in ways to cut and eliminate any science that might provide any data that might embarrass the federal government. My God. I mean, that's what the Chinese do. That's what the Communist Party of China is all. We have an environment minister who's not really an environment minister. This is a former journalist. His job is to spin like hell. That's why you got to put in the job. Harper doesn't give a damn about the environment. He hates environmentalists. Most of his party think that Greenpeace is some kind of diabolical force on the planet. So he puts in a journalist who actually thought at one time was a pretty credible journalist, who behaves like a hack for big oil and does not honor any of his mandates as environment minister. So Woodland Caribou, where are they going in northern Alberta? Oh, they're on their way to extinction. 50% on the way there due to fragmentation of the boreal forest. And what does Peter Kent say? The species does not face an imminent threat to survival at this time. Meanwhile, the government is putting together a plan that would enclose the remaining woodland caribou in the area in a fence. All right? Kind of a park line for caribou. All right, over here we'll take the tar sands, will take place. Over here, the remaining caribou that we can shovel together, we will put in a fenced enclosure. Who knows? Maybe we'll feed them to imported Chinese workers. The China car. All right. So the Chinese now have invested heavily in the tar sands since 2003. They account for nearly a third of all investments in bitumen production. This is extraordinary. Most of these investments are all coming from one of three Chinese national oil companies. These are state-owned enterprises. They are run by the Communist Party of China. They report to the Communist Party of China. They do not have public boards. There is no transparency with these corporations. If you want to get rich and really fast in China, you get yourself or your children employed by a national oil company. They are among the most heated organizations and institutions in China by ordinary people. And they do business with dictators around the world. Their environmental abuses are extraordinary, and their human rights records are terrible. And yet, these are the folks we are inviting with open arms to come and do business in the tar sands. So one of them is Petro, China. The other is Sinopec. This is, by the way, the world's seventh largest oil company on the planet. It controls almost all petroleum refining in Asia. The last chairman of this company, by the way, was fired for corruption. So where do these companies rate? When you look at Transparency International, they rate the companies. And just look at the bottom of the scale, you'll see Sinopec at 28%. You'll see Sinopec at 32%. And PetroChina at 35%. So here's their record on reporting on anti-corruption. They're at the bottom of the barrel in terms of oil companies around the planet. And oil companies don't rate very highly on this scale anyway, but they are among the worst. Here's another transparency scale. Here is their ability to disclose information fairly. They have a 0% record in this regard. And yet, these are the same companies that Stephen Harper has aggressively pursued to invest in the tar sands. The money. Here's the conversation nobody wants to have in Canada, and probably because it's so damn embarrassing. The Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, a pretty conservative organization in Europe, representing industrial nations, they looked at Canada's oil regime and said, well, things are, you're giving it away here. And they said, well, in Norway, companies receive 22% of the net revenues on oil. What's happening in Alberta? Well, companies receive 53% of the net revenues. So it's no wonder every damn state-owned oil company and multinational wants to do business in Alberta, because they're walking home with the majority of the money. Nothing is being saved for Albertans. And in fact, Murray Smith, one of our former energy ministers, as he put it elaborately or very simply, at an oil conference in Texas, he explained to people, we give it away up here. Really great way to explain it. So, and by the way, oil companies don't think twice about investing in Norway. They're quite happy with a 22% return. So the Norwegians had a conversation about their oil wealth. And they said, you know what, if we don't do something about it, it will corrupt us and destroy our democracy. And so we will save 90% of it, and it will go into a pension fund for the future, for future Norwegians. and the Norwegian government will not touch this money. And this money will not be invested in Norway. And the Norwegian government will run on taxes. And if it runs on taxes, then it will have to represent Norwegians and not the resource. It's had some problems, but basically it has worked. That sovereign fund is now worth $600 billion. What has the Canadian government said? What discussion has there been in this country about a sovereign fund? Who makes the most money in this country from the development of bitumen? It's the federal government. And they make it almost all in corporate taxes, and they make more money, approximately $5 billion a year. That's more than the royalties that Albertans make from the production of that bitumen. That's because our royalty rates are so low. One of the guys that the reason that Norway had a bit of a different experience with oil has to do with this fellow, Farouk Al-Kassim, an Iraqi engineer and geologist who, by good fortune, married a Norwegian. They had a child with cerebral palsy. They moved back to Norway in the 1970s, at the same point that Norway, pretty much a fishing nation with great hydrocarbon resources, discovered that they had oil in the North Sea. They said, holy smokes, we don't know how to develop this stuff. 4 days after his arrival, he was hired by the Norwegian government, and he stuck to his guns the whole time. He said, there are two things he must do. Go slow. Save the money. And that was his white paper report to the Norwegian government. But that's not what we're doing here in Canada. And in fact, in Canada now, we're full steam ahead. And the Harper government is saying, you know what, we need more Chinese investment, we need more Chinese funding if we want to rapidly develop the tar sands. And here, in a government document that the CBC just released, here's an interesting revelation. So this is a memo from Natural Resources Canada to the Deputy Minister of Natural Resources Canada, which is headed by Joe Oliver, who perhaps might be one of the dumbest investment bankers on the planet. And here they're saying, you know what, the cost of steel, a primary input for construction of oil sands is increasing, blah, blah, blah. Cost of labor is increasing. Finally, achieving the levels of growth forecast by various groups requires at least $100 billion in upfront investment. So what are those levels of growth? Well, 3.7 million barrels of oil by 2025, or in the case of Enbridge's estimates, 6 million barrels of oil by 2025. So here the federal government is submitting, we can't get to any of those artificial growth targets without Chinese money. No discussion about whether we should actually go there or what the vulnerabilities and liabilities associated with that kind of growth might be. How are you going to deal with the climate implications of that sort of thing? How are you going to deal with the labor implications, the water contamination, the fact that we still haven't got a credible federal environmental monitoring program going on up there? Nope. It's just Stephen Harper thinking the Americans are not going to want this product. We're already overproducing it. What do we do next? Bring in the Chinese. One or two last things I want to add here to sort of flesh out the scale of the mistake we've made as a people here. All right, so this project is located in the Mackenzie River Basin, third largest basin on the planet. You've got the Mississippi, the Amazon, and you've got the Great Mackenzie. And so the project is right smack dab in this. And we now know, with huge water demands, and it has the potential to contaminate really a sixth of Canada's fresh water. It's all located in that basin. So if something really goes wrong in the tar sands, one of the mining impoundments collapses, or something to that effect, then we've got a huge problem downstream. And who lives downstream? Merle will tell you who lives downstream. It's First Nations people. So David Schindler did some research 2 years ago. He said, okay, what about all this atmospheric pollution we get from the upgrading of this resource in Fort McMurray? Where's all that shit going? And what is it? And up until that point, industry and the Alberta government had said, this project is an example of immaculate conception. There is no pollution. And David Schindler said, that's bullshit, that can't be true. You can't produce 2 million barrels of oil a day and mine a boreal landscape on this scale and not have some pollution. And so he went looking for it, which nobody else had done up until that point. And he simply measured contaminants in snowpack and the volume at which they accumulated and melted into the Athabasca River in springtime. And what he found was they were off the charts for nearly a dozen heavy metals and chemicals beyond legal levels flowing into the Athabasca River every spring during spring melt as all of this stuff flushed into the Athabasca River, and it was equivalent to an oil spill the size of 5,000 to 13,000 barrels every year. And the response of the federal government and the Alberta government was that Schindler was a crank. This can't be happening. But there was an international uproar about it because all of his data was published in the most credible scientific journals on the planet. And as a result, the federal government then had to go back and do some of this research, which they are not now presenting in Canada, but they are now presenting in California, confirming that everything that Schindler said was true, and not only that, it's much worse. And so these contaminants probably explain why people in Fort Chip, 300 kilometers downstream from the tar sands, are pulling deformed and cancerous fish out of Lake Athabasca. These contaminants may play a role in explaining why there are higher than expected levels of bile duct, lymphatic, and blood cancers in the community of Fort Chip, in fact 30% higher than what you would expect in a community of 1,000 people downstream. Then we've got other issues here. We've got the Commissioner of Environment and Sustainable Development talking about what's going on up there and saying, you know, is there any credible monitoring? Because when Schindler's report came out, the government said, well, don't worry, we've got the best monitoring there is. The Auditor General corrected them and said, insufficient data to monitor oil sands. The Department's Freshwater Quality Monitoring Program has no baseline measures or long-term data to track changes in water quality and aquatic ecosystem health in the river. That same report said, you know what, there's one station, one federal monitoring station downstream of the oil sands, and it's not calibrated to measure bitumen pollution. It was only calibrated to measure pulp pollution. Same commissioner coming up with a different report. How are things faring? Going well? Not getting any better. Incomplete environmental baselines and environmental data monitoring systems have made it impossible to consider in a thorough and systematic manner the cumulative environmental effects of oil sands projects in that region. And yet Harper is going to China to expand this project 3 times. We have problems with the steam plants. This is the other form of production. Take natural gas, take a whole bunch of water, boil it, inject it into the ground, melt the bitumen, bring it to surface. Huge risks of contamination to groundwater in the region. What do we know about those risks? Here's Natural Resources Canada admitting size unknown, status unknown, risk unknown. Some of these underwater groundwater channels in Fort McMurray region extend all the way to Hudson Bay. You fuck up that groundwater in northern Alberta, and you will see the consequences in Hudson Bay here in Manitoba. What do we know about it? Knowledge is lacking. This seems to be part of the whole Canadian experience. We'll develop a resource, even if we don't have the knowledge to know what the consequences might be. And how are we going to reclaim the landscape? Here's another big environmental issue. The fact that, you know, this is a mining project. It comes with mining waste. You take bitumen out of the ground, you wash it with hot water, you separate it from the sand and the clay, and you've got oil and sand and clay and heavy metals all mixed up in this mining waste. What do you do with it? Well, you stick it in a pond. These ponds are huge. They extend over an area of more than 180 square kilometers at this point in time, no longer 170. They look like this. They look like hell, smell like hell, and maybe drop dead if they stand on the shore of these things for a long time. So we've got 6 billion barrels of toxic waste. In other words, we could build a 10 by 10 meter canal, much larger than the Rideau Canal, from Vancouver to Halifax and fill it with mining waste from the tar sands. No problem. This is a $20 billion liability to clean up, according to the Risk Metrics Group. And of course, what is the Alberta government collected and saved for that purpose? $1 billion. Even the Royal Society of Canada says that's a problem. The current system lacks a reasonable systematic risk management approach to avoid claims on the public purse arising from an inadequate financial security due to reclamation. So we're very good at taking boreal landscapes that look like this, turning them into landscapes that look like this, some of the largest mined landscapes on the planet, and then doing something like this, and we're calling it equivalent land capability. So we're not restoring anything. We're not redoing anything. We're taking something that is pretty whole and important. It does a great job at sequestering carbon, filtering water, making moose, regulating water flow, and we're turning it into an impoverished environment with much less biological diversity. And in fact, 60% of the mineable landscape are peatlands. We're digging that up and destroying it. It takes 10,000 years to make a peatland, and it's not something the Harper is interested in doing. Last but not least, the carbon liabilities. All right, so production of 1.5 million barrels a day, we're closer to 2, we're around 50 million tons a day. 50 million tons of carbon, CO2 a year in the tar sands. So what is that? That's about 7% of Canada's national emissions. By 2020, we'll be closer to 18 or 20% of Canada's national emissions. So this one project will be making more emissions than the entire transportation network of the country, more than our cars and our trucks. And we have no plan to deal with this. So there's the trajectory for emission. And here's Mark Jacquard, one of Canada's foremost climate modelers and scientists. Our political leaders are lying to us if they aid and abet the expansion of tar sands. Notice, this is a scientist from Simon Fraser, actually using the term tar sands, how dare you, while promising to take action to prevent the imminent climate catastrophe. You do one or the other, you don't do both. So where do we go? And what do we need as Canadians to start thinking about it? And so whenever I sort of get overwhelmed by the scale of this dangerous enterprise and its impact on our culture, our character, and our economy, I come back to St. Francis. So we start by doing what's necessary, then we do what's possible, and suddenly we're doing the impossible. Suddenly you can sort of feel some peace about the whole thing. Okay, so where do we begin? This guy is probably one of the most dangerous political leaders we have had in decades, and the majority of Canadians have not yet woken up to the fact that we have an extremist in Ottawa who will sell out the country for bitumen production at any cost, who has attacked environmental groups, who has attacked charitable groups, who has gutted environmental legislation, who has censored science and scientists, and who has destroyed our reputation as a fair and just country around the world. He is remaking Canada in his own image, and he is using Petro dollars to do what Margaret Thatcher did to England. Make that clear to your friends, your relatives, your neighbors, and your fellow citizens. We have communities throughout Canada that are saying no to these pipelines and these projects. They need your support. First Nations have a very simple salute for this whole thing. I mean, the Gateway Pipeline will not pass. It will not be built. And so these guys, the Winnipeg Wells, will be saved. Let's hope. foremost, I guess we need to demand a national debate about the scale and pace of this project because it has hijacked our character and our politics. And as Canadians, we are afraid to have this debate. We're having it now on pipelines, but we need to have a direct deal on the pace and scale of this project, and we need also to talk about the money. We need a national carbon tax. We can't have a project like this, you know, and not address climate change. So for every kilogram of carbon this project has produced, two should have been taken off the table elsewhere in the economy with a plan. Got to take the money off the table. If you don't take resource money off the table and put it into pension funds or sovereign funds, the same thing applies to the money made by Manitoba Hydro here, then you will not be represented as a citizen. Governments will run on this money. They love this resource revenue because they don't have to tax you, they don't have to consult you, they don't have to represent you. And this is the fundamental challenge facing Canada. We have failed to address this whole issue. We've sold off our trees, we've sold off uranium, we've sold off every goddamn thing there is to sell off in this country of ours. And we have not saved a freaking dime for the future or for our children. Why can we not have that conversation? Why can we not sit down like Norwegians and think about the future of this country? An energy diet. It goes without saying. But we will not see any energy diet. We will not see any energy transition as long as the government of Saskatchewan, the government of Alberta, the government of British Columbia, and the federal government of Canada are allowed to run on revenues from hydrocarbon production. Why would they cut off that cheap and easy flow of money by promoting decentralized, renewable, low technology forms of energy? They're not going there. Last word belongs to Nicholas Nassim Taleb. Really smart guy, used to be a quant trader in New York, great mathematician, thinks that modern economics is largely a fraud. And he's right. We become civilized only by knowing what to refrain from doing. And that applies to what happened in Lake St. Martin, too. That was not the behavior of civilized people. That was the behavior of barbaric people. And we must learn, all of us, how to say no. And to become more politically engaged than we are comfortable that we've been comfortable doing at this point in time. So I think I probably said more than enough. Thank you very much, and I welcome any questions, any discussion.